2, 1 through 20. The birth of Jesus Christ. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary and his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. The shepherds and the angels. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born the day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child, and all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them.
Thank you, Brinkley. Hey, it's Christmas time, which is super duper exciting. I know I am just absolutely pumped for Christmas. I love Christmas. I love the Christmas decorations, bless you. I love Christmas music. I love Christmas movies. I love everything about Christmas. Who here loves Christmas? All right, now I know we have two schools of thought in here, all right? So who decorates for Christmas before Thanksgiving? Anybody? Who says, nope, you got to wait till after Thanksgiving? All right, about half and half. It's kind of what I expected. Our family decorates before Thanksgiving. I know. And I tell you what, we started this a few years ago, okay? And I was totally against it, all right? I was totally against decorating before Thanksgiving, because you got Halloween, and then you got Thanksgiving, and then you got Christmas. But a few years ago, we decided to start decorating before Thanksgiving. I'll never go back. I absolutely love it. There is something about Christmas that is just exciting. There is something about Christmas that, like, November 1st hits, and I am just pumped because I get to do the coolest thing on my birthday. I get to decorate for Christmas. November 1st is my birthday. We decorate for Christmas on my birthday every year since a few years ago. And I will never go back. I absolutely love it. Have you noticed how the atmosphere is just different around Christmas? There is just something that is exciting. There is some anticipation. There is some experience that we are experiencing that we don't experience any other time of the year. What is it about Christmas and this time of year that makes it so exciting? That's the big question tonight. What is it about this time of year, about Christmas, that makes things so exciting? Now, some would say it's the gifts. And gifts are super exciting. I know I have a list. I am excited for my gifts that I'm going to get this year. But I've noticed, especially the last few years, that I get just as excited about watching people open their gifts as I do about opening my gifts. As a matter of fact, I get even more excited about watching people open their gifts than I do opening my own gifts. And there's something different about that. Like, the gifts are cool and they're exciting, but there's something deeper than the gifts. And you may say, all right, CJ, you're an old man. You know, that's what adults are supposed to do. They're supposed to get excited about other people. But I can distinctly remember sitting around the Christmas tree in junior high school thinking it was really weird because I just enjoyed watching everybody else. And I remember looking at all my cousins and, like, they just could not wait to tear into their gifts. And I was sitting back and I was like, this is really odd, but, like, I'm more excited to watch everybody else's excitement. And I realize as I've gotten older, and that's just kind of grown, that there's something deeper than the gifts around Christmas that makes it so exciting. What is it about Christmas that makes it so exciting? And you all know where I'm going with this. It's Jesus, right? Brinkley read the story of Jesus' birth, God coming to earth to save us from our sins. And we hear that story over and 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 over until, you know, it kind of becomes numb, maybe. I mean, it's a special story, but there's something about, you know, when you say a word over and over and over and over, it starts to sound weird. Right? Try it sometime when you go home. Just pick a word and start saying it. Home, 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 home. Eventually, it starts to sound really weird in your head. That's, I think, what happens with the Christmas story. We've become desensitized to the Christmas story because we have heard it so many times. We lose some of the excitement and some of it gets lost in translation. So today, I want to kind of set the stage for what the people of that time experienced leading up to Christmas.
Oh dear. I've seen this before. Slave fever, they call it. Pressure of Christmas sends a man.
No, you're good. You're good. That actually is perfect. Because it's weird when you expect something to happen and there's just silence. Like, everybody starts thinking, oh no, what's going on? Like, maybe I should be playing a video. Maybe CJ, what is he doing? Why isn't he saying anything? You expect me to keep talking, and when I... stop. That's weird. And listen, the people that had followed God for generations were told, there is a Messiah coming. He's going to come. He's going to come quickly. And God spoke through prophets, and God spoke to people, and people proclaimed for God that there was this Messiah coming, and people said, I'm a voice for God, and God is crying out. And then, between the Old Testament and the New Testament, there was just silence. Nothing. There was no word from God. There were no prophets saying, I'm speaking for God. There were no appearances of angels. Just silence. Can you imagine the awkwardness of being told your entire life, the Messiah's coming, he's coming soon. It could happen any day, it could come any moment, and then nothing. And all of a sudden, one day, an angel appears and breaks the silence to Mary and her future husband, Joseph, and says, you are going to have a son. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the excitement and the nervousness and the anticipation and how weird it must have felt? And then the day comes for Jesus to be born, and the silence is just shattered as these angels show up to these shepherds, and the shepherds are like, holy cow, what is going on? I love their reaction when they hear that Jesus is born. Check this out. It's in Luke, the last part that Brinkley read. It says this. It says, and they went with great haste. Now, if you're a shepherd, if you're taking care of animals, you don't do anything quickly. You got to make sure your animals are cared for. You got to make sure they're not going to get attacked. You got to make sure they're not going to wander off. But these shepherds were so excited at the breaking of silence that they went with great haste. And they found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that has been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them. Silence was broken. It was shattered. There was this anticipation and this excitement. What is it about Christmas that makes it so unbelievably exciting? For those of us that follow Jesus, it's Jesus. It's Jesus. He came into this world and he left heaven and he came to earth and he paid the penalty that we could never pay. And he became human and he experienced all the things that we experience and he was tempted. And then he went and he died for our sins and he paid our penalty so that we could spend eternity with God. And he wants us to have this life with him that is absolutely incredible and amazing. That's the reason we celebrate if we know who Jesus is. But here's the thing. The excitement around Christmas is not just limited to those that follow Jesus, is it? Like, there's excitement across the board around Christmas. Isn't there? I mean, every store, every person you meet is excited about Christmas. So, what is it about Christmas that makes it so exciting? For us, it's Jesus, but what is it for everyone else that makes Christmas so exciting? And I've come to this conclusion. Are you ready? Here it is. It's Jesus. Now, I know. I just said, what is it that makes Christmas so exciting for those that don't follow Jesus? It would seem that Jesus is not the answer that makes Christmas so exciting for those that don't follow Jesus. That's odd, but stay with me because I think our culture has one major thing in common with the culture that Jesus Christ was born into. And it's this. Silence. Our culture is searching for something. And they don't necessarily recognize it, but they're searching for Jesus. You know, we started decorating our Christmas tree on November 1st. And on November 1st, we started one other thing. We said, hey, Google, play Christmas hits. And that started a Google Music, or Spotify, I guess, playlist that was just Christmas hits from across the years. Christmas music. We play Christmas music pretty much constantly at our house. It's very rare for it not to be on. We play Christmas music a lot. But this year, I have recognized something about Christmas music, which has made me recognize something about Christmas movies, which has made me recognize something about Christmas culture in general. There are a lot, and I mean a lot, if you pay attention, of Christmas songs about love. There are Christmas songs about falling in love at Christmas time. There are Christmas songs about losing love at Christmas time. There are Christmas songs about hoping to be in love at Christmas time. There are Christmas songs about just in general being in love at Christmas time. There are a ton of Christmas songs about love. Now, you look at Christmas movies. The Hallmark Channel makes its money based off this idea that Christmas time centers around love. I don't watch Hallmark movies, but I've heard enough conversation that that's pretty much what it is, right? It's just centered around love. But you think about other movies, like your favorite Christmas movie, The Grinch. It's all about the Grinch finding love and belonging in the end. Home Alone, it's all about Kevin McAllister getting back together with his family again in the end. You think about your favorite Christmas movie, even Elf, right? Classic, one of the greatest Christmas movies, if not the greatest Christmas movie of all time. Elf is about Buddy the Elf finding love and a relationship with his dad. You see, Christmas is so exciting because it is the one time of the year, more than any other time of the year, where we are just blasted with experiencing love. We get together with family. There's smiles and there's laughter, and we give gifts and we receive gifts, and there's just this excitement of love. And here's what I'm convinced of. I am convinced that our culture is living in silence of the love they were intended to receive. We were intended to receive the love of God our Father, this perfect, incredible, amazing, undeniable love. And it's around Christmas time where, as a culture, as a whole, we experience on just a very small level this glimpse of heaven where we get to experience love. And I'm convinced that the thing that makes Christmas so exciting is this idea that deep inside of ourselves, we get to experience what we were created to experience all along. And I know our culture is searching for Jesus and waiting for Jesus and desperate for Jesus because our culture is searching for, waiting for, and desperate for love. You look around Christmas, you look at all this stuff, our culture is desperate for love. And Jesus is the love that they are desperate for. And I'm convinced that's what makes Christmas so exciting, because we get to experience a small, very small, minute bit of the love that we were truly created to experience. Here's the truth. The truth is that you are loved. And some of you are sitting in this room and you know that and you feel that and you feel that regularly. And some of you are sitting in this room and you are feeling like you are sitting in silence. I want to tell you tonight, as we look forward to this Christmas season, you are loved. God broke the silence. He came to find you. He came to rescue you. He came to save you. He came so that he would have a life where you get to experience him and he gets to experience you. One of my favorite Christmas movies outside of Elf is not a very well-known Christmas movie. It's called Arthur Christmas. Anybody ever heard it? Okay, some of you. All right, awesome. One of my favorites. We watch it every year. Arthur Christmas centers around this family of Santa Clauses, right? You've got Grandpa Santa, who used to be Santa. He's retired, and they're doing things a new way, and he does not like that they're doing things a new way. You've got the current Santa Claus, who kind of is the figurehead, but he's not really running the show. You've got Santa's son, Steve, who is really running the show and wants to take over as Santa Claus. But Santa refuses to retire. And then you've got Arthur, who is also Santa Claus's son, and he is an outcast. Well, this movie centers around this idea that in Santa's workshop, one of the toys gets pushed aside and a child gets missed. And Santa is too tired to do anything about it. Steve decides that it's just one child and it's 0.00000 something 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 percent, and that's basically a total success anyway, so what's one child matter? And Grandpa Santa decides to go out, but he just wants to go out so he can prove the old way is better than the new way. But then there's Arthur, and Arthur will stop at nothing. He will stop at nothing to make sure that this little girl that wrote a letter to Santa knows that Santa came and that he cares. And so they goes on this incredible trip, and they fly through Canada, and they get they don't realize that Toronto is there, and they like bust a balloon, and then they go into New Mexico and they get fired at because they think they're UFOs, and then they end up in Africa and they end up fighting lions. And at the end of the day, the sleigh goes up into the atmosphere, and they get kind of dumped, and the reindeer just kind of take off out of fear, and they're stuck on a beach in the right at the ocean, and Arthur decides he is still not going to give up. He wants to make sure that this little girl knows that Santa came and he cares. Check this out. There you go. So this is an incredible movie. Arthur stops at nothing to make sure that this little girl knows that Santa came and he cares. And here's the reason I show you that clip, because Arthur experienced a lot of things that he was never intended to experience. Arthur was supposed to be the man that just sat and wrote letters back to the kids. And the truth about Christmas is that Jesus stops at nothing to know how loved you are. Jesus stops at nothing for you to know how incredibly loved you are. He was supposed to be the king that stayed in heaven, and instead he came to earth and experienced all kinds of things that he was never supposed to experience, so that you would recognize that you are loved with this incredible, unimaginable, overwhelming, never-ending love. That's this love that is beyond anything that we could ever imagine experiencing. And this Christmas, when you feel the excitement, maybe for you, you're sitting in silence. I want to encourage you, whether you are feeling like you are sitting in silence or whether you feel loved on a regular basis, as you think about the excitement of Christmas this year, I want you to just remind yourself how truly loved you are. And so I give a practical challenge every single week. Just a thing that says, if I want to take a next step in my faith, what's the thing that I could do? I think, in some sense, we all live in silence. There are times in all of our lives where we don't necessarily feel or allow ourselves to feel loved. And Christmas, the excitement of Christmas is about how that's just not true. We don't live in silence. And the silence has been broken. And the silence has been shattered. And the truth is that you are loved. And so this Christmas, when you start to get excited, when you think about the excitement, when you walk into a store and see excited people and decorations all around, this Christmas, I want you to simply say, I am loved. I'm loved. I am loved with this incredible, amazing, unbelievable love. And I want you this Christmas season to repeat that to yourself over and over and over again. Because we need to hear that. Our culture needs to hear that. You are loved. Check this out.